Hi, everybody. I'm Soledad O'Brien. I'm a journalist and I'm an entrepreneur, and I am delighted to be able to welcome you to today's roundtable event that is brought to you by Intuit QuickBooks, TurboTax, and MailChimp. Today is the first day of Hispanic Heritage Month in the U.S., and according to U.S. Census estimates, Hispanic-owned employers make up roughly 6% of the total nationwide, so that's just about 331,000 businesses. And according to a new QuickBooks survey, which is out today, 9 out of 10 Hispanic small businesses, business owners, say that someone in their family inspired them or encouraged them to make the leap to go it alone. 60% of respondents who are Hispanic small business owners say that their families significantly encouraged them to start their own business. So our theme today is Unidos We Grow. And we're going to talk a little bit about the incredibly diverse communities within the larger Hispanic, Latino, and Latina universe, and how we can increase prosperity for consumers and small businesses together. We're going to discuss all the ways that the community and the culture can impact your growth, especially in the beginning of your financial success journey. And we're also going to talk a little bit about some of the challenges that come with starting and running a small business as well. So I want to say a big welcome to the folks who are watching today all over the country, all around the world. Some of you are experienced small business owners and entrepreneurs. Others might be working for businesses, whether they're large or small, but you're dreaming maybe of starting your own company. And some of you might just be beginning that journey right now, but don't exactly know how to get started. But there's one thing that you all have in common. You have a story that's worth sharing. So if you're joining us live, check out the Roundtable chat. It's located right below the video player. Or you can join us on Twitter. Make sure you use the hashtag UnidosWeGrow. Tell us your story. Share some of the things that you've learned, advice. Or just start smashing that heart emoji a lot. I love that. And also make sure you check out the resources section just below the chat window for terrific information about how to start and grow your business, build your customer base, and of course, manage your taxes. So our very first guest today is someone who's broken so many barriers and won lots of acclaim with his incisive and absolutely hilarious understanding of his own community and culture. George Lopez is a film and TV actor, and of course, he's a stand-up comedian who led the way for Latino comics by embracing his ethnicity and also confronting racial stereotypes. So George Lopez Foundation raises awareness for kidney disease and organ donation, and also works to improve the quality of life for underprivileged kids and adults and military families as well. Hi, George. It's so nice to see you. It's so nice to welcome you.
Thank you. Good to see you, Soledad.
Thank you. All right. I would like to start, kick this all off with a couple of questions for you. And, you know, in that short intro I did, I ticked off a lot of things that you're involved in. Your stand-up career, obviously, that led to TV and then film roles, and that allowed you to give back through the George Lopez Foundation. And of course, your career as an entrepreneur, booming. You're working at a kind of crazy pace when you think about it, as are lots of the people who are in the audience today. Talk to me a little bit about your drive, where you started. Did you envision all of this at the very beginning? How did it begin?
I don't think I've ever met anybody who didn't have any pictures of themselves as a baby, or maybe had come from such a fractured family that I have. You know, I didn't know my father ever, and I wasn't raised by my mother, and my biological grandmother was pretty hard on me. And my grandfather, who was not biological, took me to work with him. He dug ditches and sewers. It took me to work with him when I was 12. And by 7:15, I had blisters across like all this from putting dirt into a wheelbarrow and dumping it. And I was done probably by 9:30, and he made me stay all day and made me work. And then on the way home, he said, okay, why I brought you? And I was like, to torture me? And he said, this is what I want you to remember. You can work with your hands or you can work with your head. And I never had a choice. I had to work with my hands. And I decided at that point right there that out of respect to him and his very few lessons that he taught me, but very valuable lessons that I would work with my head. And then I just started to, irregardless of whether anybody believed in me or not, I found a way to connect things that eventually led me to believing in myself.
That's a great story. And I think, in all your comedy, your love for your community always comes through. And you talk a lot about your roots and refer back to them. You know, a lot of entrepreneurs will talk about, and I'm one, I run a small business, and it's hard to wear all of these different hats, right? How do you do it? How do you think about prioritizing all the things that you're doing? Because clearly you've got film and TV and you're still doing your stand. I mean, how do you juggle it all? How do you prioritize?
Well, I also grew up around people that were never on time. And I think to be efficient as a business person or be efficient anything in life, you have to be on time. If you're late, you're late. It just shows a lot to people, even if you're late for the first time. Oh, listen, I'm sorry, you got caught in traffic, although I won't be late again. You can never be late. So in those lessons of that, and also, you know, when things get tough, if you don't have anybody around you to, I wouldn't say inspire you, but to look to say, you know, sometimes things are going to be tough and sometimes you're just going to have to just plow through it, you know, don't quit. But I didn't have that. And I remember my grandmother, I begged her for accordion lessons. I mean, imagine. I just wanted to perform at anything and be in the accordion. So she paid for 10 lessons. I maybe did two. And then I had to hear about how I quit when it got tough. And then my baseball coach in high school said to me that when it got tough, I quit. And it hit me that it was true. And I look back on my life and everything that was very difficult to me, I quit. And I didn't realize it till I was maybe 4 years out of high school. And one day I went back to the high school and I knew the baseball coach would be putting the equipment away. And I walked over to him. And as I got closer, you could see him kind of recognize me. He's like, what are you doing here? And I said, I came to apologize to you for the way that I treated you, the way that I disrespected you, and the way that I acted when I was, you know, around you. And he said, is that why you came out here? And I said, yeah. And then he said, you know, put his hand out, we shook hands, and he said, there might be hope for you yet. And I was maybe 23, and that was the first time that I'd ever apologized to somebody, because culturally, a lot of times we just remove those people from our lives. You know, even my grandmother would say, you know, that's my sister. Like, I didn't know you have a sister. I don't, you know, so we have to be able to say sorry. We have to be able to own our mistakes, and we have to be able to understand when we've received a lesson and to be thankful for the lesson.
Yeah, I love that. And prioritizing being on time and showing up is really good advice. For a lot of entrepreneurs, and I'll include myself in this, managing money, you know, if that's not what you sort of grew up knowing and doing and studying, it can be really, really hard. Did you know about managing finances when you started your own business?
No, I would say I did not. You know, and I came from places where people live paycheck to paycheck. And, you know, you have to understand that even $5 a week or saving $10 or whatever you can put away. And they would say rainy day, but every day is potentially a rainy day. We look at things like put things away for the future, but the future is now. We need to start thinking in this moment and not 2 or 3 years down the line, even if it's just little steps going forward. And, you know, now because of the diverse area and the diverse world we live in, you see Latinos who are smart with money. You see people who have degrees, and you're not seeing somebody for the first time. Like when I was growing up, I saw somebody that could manage their money for the first time. And now they're all around us, and we have to start to use them as assets and as helpful things to all of us, male, female, young, old, Latino, whoever you are. I mean, it's really the currency of the money is one thing, but also knowing and having knowledge is also currency.
Yeah, recognize the expertise. And now there's so much expertise in our own community to leverage. In fact, I'm going to introduce you to some really wonderful entrepreneurs. Let's begin with Kathy Cano Murillo. She's known probably better to everybody as the Crafty Chica. Kathy, nice to see you. You specialize in Latino crafts. We can see a whole bunch of them behind you, helping Latinos make decorations and jewelry and home decor. Talk to me a little bit about your path and why this was important to you.
Hi, Soledad. So I have just always loved to make things. And I've always been that entrepreneur at heart. And I was working at the Arizona Republic. I was a craft columnist. And I realized in the craft industry, which is like a $41 billion industry, there was not a lot of Latino representation. You couldn't find craft tutorials online. You couldn't find craft products. You couldn't find anything like that. So I thought, I'm going to save the world with craft supplies and craft products. And I decided to launch Crafty Chica 21 years ago. And it has been booming. I do it full time now. It's my main business. And from workshops to retreats to designing products to the craft tutorials, it's just taking something you love and scaling it up and finding all of those different outlets. And basically, it's serving our community. I look at it like there's a lot of creative Latinas out there who maybe are not fine artists. Maybe they just want to sew or make pillows or honor their grandmother who used to sew. And I love to provide those types of projects and products for them to use and celebrate culture.
Amazing.
And you can see the colors from a mile away too. All the bright colors, and you can see them.
Absolutely gorgeous. And saving the world. I love that. What a tiny goal, saving the world.
Yes.
Up next for our entrepreneurs is Andreas de Oliveira. Andreas was a chef for many years, and then he was a finalist on the first season of MasterChef Latino. And now Andreas shows people how to cook delicious food on social media. So Andreas, nice to see you. How do you balance the appeal? Because of course, you've got a lot of people who follow you who speak Venezuelan Spanish, and then you're also trying to appeal to everybody in the world and cooking is cooking, even for those of us who can't necessarily speak Spanish fluently.
You know, one of the things, first of all, hi to everyone. One of the things is that food is a universal language. You know, I've gone to many places in the world where, you know, I may not speak their language, but we can speak food. And that has been one of the things that has helped me break that barrier of like jumping outside of my Venezuelan community, which was the one that jumpstarted my, you know, online cooking career. But definitely, what I did is I made food the hero. You know, I basically stopped talking, you know, I made the videos more quieter and let the food do the talking. And that has been the way that, you know, I was able to transition and expand myself outside of my Venezuelan community.
I love it. I love it. And finally, let's welcome Brittany Castro. Brittany, you were just 22 years old when you started your career as a financial advisor. 15 years later, you sold that practice and you decided that you would focus on financial literacy at scale. So what do you think are the things, Brittany, that people don't understand about financial planning?
Well, good morning, everybody. You know, financial planning is ongoing. So I would say that's the biggest thing to learn. It's not like a one time you create a financial plan and then you're set for life, because as we all know, life doesn't go according to plan, right? We need to put a plan in place and then adapt and change and evolve. And I feel that the sooner you start understanding money, of course, and you could learn all the different topics and strategies and continue to refine your knowledge and strategies and systems, but really understanding that it never ends, because I always like to communicate to people like money is just another relationship we have in our lives and it's going to be around forever. So the sooner we start to have and create that healthy relationship with money, the better. And one thing I always like to remind people is really no one comes out of the womb with financial wisdom and knowledge. It is a learned skill. Some people maybe learned it in their childhood through, you know, their parents or education, but most of us don't. And really at some point in your lives, you have to say, I want to learn this. I want to learn finances. I want to learn money. I'm going to commit to learning and relearning and practicing, and it's not going to be easy. And sometimes I'm going to make mistakes. Most of the time you're going to make, you know, mistakes, but you're going to learn from them and you're going to continue to hopefully just improve and refine all of those different strategies. And another thing is, you know, technology really has changed a lot of the financial world. I mean, what I was doing 15 years ago when I first started versus now with technology, it's like we could do things instantly, which is different. So all of us, no matter how old or young or background, you have to keep learning and have that open mindset to be willing to be a student of the game and never feel like, yeah, I've mastered it, because I've worked with a lot of people and I don't really know anybody who's mastered their money. I mean, people have had success with their finances, but even those people are constantly working on it and learning it and growing and evolving their own financial wisdom and expertise.
I really like thinking about it like a journey, you know, not if I read this book, I'm good, I'm done. I don't have to, you know, keep growing. I think that's really great advice. So I wanted to throw some questions at you guys and just have you sort of all together talk about some of these issues. So there's a new QuickBooks survey found, and this is, I don't think, going to be a surprise to any of you, that it's often harder for Hispanic-owned businesses to get funding to start or to grow their business. And I'm curious, and maybe George, I'll start with you. Has that been your experience? I mean, was there ever a time where you were trying to get funders or someone to come on board so you could expand and it was just impossible to go the traditional banking route?
Well, you know, I think that there's also a thing in us that, you know, to be able to ask somebody for help is considered a weakness in our culture. To be able to say, listen, I need some assistance, I need some help. And a lot of the times when you see other people who succeed in something that you felt uncomfortable doing, we've limited ourselves and we've hurt ourselves. So we can't be afraid to be able to say that I need help, or to be able to look for things and not just assume that the door's closed, because it doesn't come easy to you. Like if the door's closed, find a door that's open or look for an opportunity somewhere else. There's another door. And there's always something available, and don't just give up the first, second, or third time. Keep trying.
Mm. Did you find that, Andres? Did you have to keep going back and back? You had great success, and in a very public way, did that make it easier for you to get funding when you wanted some funding to expand or to grow?
You know, for me, and the one experience I had is when I was trying to get just a mortgage, going the traditional banking route was a bit difficult. And I ended up getting, you know, financing for, you know, for the kitchen studio that we live in, that we use now to work and to film our videos, through another Latino who is a mortgage broker. And, you know, they're kind of, you know, they're easier to work with, and it's not a cultural thing. It's just that I guess they kind of understand, you know, they come from the same place we come from, and it's not so square as most of the traditional banking systems that are out there. So for me, in my experience, yes, it was a bit tough to get just regular funding to a traditional banking system. And it was just easier to get it, you know, with the help of, unfortunately, my own people, you know?
And Kathy, how about for you? You said you've been in this business now a minute, and now you're doing it full time. That transition from a part-time hobby to a full-time mm-hmm. successful business, were you struggling to get financial support from maybe traditional organizations?
You know, my story's a little different. I really haven't ever applied for loans. I've been very self-funded all the way. I did get a PPP loan during the pandemic, when at the time I co-owned a retail store, and that really came in handy. But aside from that, it's been all self-funded, of taking a dollar and turning it into $100 and just cracking the code of how to do that.
That's amazing. So it makes sense, this next question, that in a new Intuit QuickBooks survey, that the one that's out today, 96% of Hispanic business owners surveyed said they would offer financial support to people in their family when they're able to. 83% said they would offer financial support to people in their community. That makes sense. Obviously, you know, we just talked about sometimes traditional banking being a bit of a challenge. So maybe, George, I'll start with you on that. You had mentioned a little bit of you know, turning to family members. Were you able to overcome your initial hesitancy, and you came from very humble roots, to be able to ask folks for help?
I I did not, you know, I had a very tough time doing that. And, you know, when I became a stand-up, it's a very singular business. And I don't think I ever really thought of myself as part of a group or part of a something bigger. So I think that my goals were even limited. I didn't limit myself goal-wise, but I knew that I wasn't going to quit. And I knew that if I kept going and doing something, that something would happen, either it would happen or not happen. But in starting to get a little more comfortable around people, then I started to look at situations. You know, Arsenio Hall was very instrumental in my career. In 1989, he saw me at an improv and put me on, and 30 years later, we're still friends. You know, Sandra Bullock saw me, of all the comedians, and we started to put the show together. So, you know, those things, I even though I struggled to accept the help, once I did, it drew a lot of emotion out of me. So that, like, very, you know, in tears and just this kind of unbelievable thing that something would happen to me. But we shouldn't be in tears every time something good happens to us. We should be able to accept those things as not a dream, but a goal. You know, I thought of things as dreams. I thought that a dream of being a comedian, a dream of having a show, but those are not dreams. Those are goals. If I wanted to breathe underwater or fly, that's a dream. But I think we look at things that are attainable for other cultures as dreams, and they're not dreams, they're goals.
Yeah, I understand why it's emotional, right? Because someone giving you a loan is saying, I believe in that goal. I believe in that dream, and I'm going to, you know, I'm going to back it up with some help.
There's a thing now that I didn't understand, but you can manifest your destiny. You can look at something and say, I want to do that. And then you go and look at making it happen. It's almost like playing fetch. You're playing fetch with your life. You know, I'm at Universal Studios. When I was 13, the trams go by, and I stood looking over this studio and thought, one day when I grow up, I want to be there. And here I am. And I see the trams go by all day, and it makes me love my grandfather and my grandmother and my community and my people, all people, but also, you know, our people more, because I see us doing things, and it is inspiring.
So, Brittany, I'm curious. I'm sure you've had to navigate this with clients of yours, right? Is it great to accept money from, I mean, people who say, hey, I have a relative and they need to be funded? Are there giant risks in accepting money from loved ones?
I mean, it could go both ways, right? I think with money from family members, you just want to be very clear on both sides, you know, and kind of treat it like a gift. That's what I would advise clients. Like, treat this money like a gift. You might never get it back, and you have to be good with that. Because if it's a family relationship, I mean, to me, relationships are more important than the money. So I would always say, you know, go into it, be very clear about what this is, how much you're going to pay it back in X amount of years. I don't know. Sometimes you can charge an interest rate and do like that kind of thing. Or maybe you just say it's an interest free, you know, loan that I'm going to give you. I just want it back in 2 years, 5 years. But I think the person giving that loan just needs to be very clear. You might never get that back, and you have to be good with it, because you don't want that to hinder any relationship, especially if it's like parents and kids. Or to me, I think those relationships are very important. You want to maintain them. So that's how I would always advise if clients were giving money either way, when it was around family, because we've all seen it. We've seen the stories. We've heard the stories. Maybe it even happened to our own family or circles where something went sour and then that relationship is cut. Like, George, you know, like, that's also part of the culture, right? Like, you did me wrong. You're out of my life. Like, and to me, that's not always the best approach to relationships. So yeah, be, you know, very clear and upfront.
I think people need to understand how critical, how important, and how vital what she said was. You know, when you, if you say, you know what, just here, you can have it, but if it's not understood, then you'll drive by somebody's house and you'll see the people that you owe money to, and you'll be like, man, I can't go. You'll go over there, and now you're avoiding people. And my an aunt borrowed $200 from me and didn't want to see her mother for 8 years. And I'm like, you know what? It's $200. You can have it. Don't worry about it. And, you know, I don't care if they were going to turn your lights off. Don't keep it. Just go and see your mom. I mean, it's $200.
Yeah,
so true.
I get that. So Brittany, if I can ask a follow-up on that, because, you know, a lot of the reason you hit up your relatives is because you don't want to take on debt necessarily, right? And that seems very, very scary. So what kinds of questions, before I get to our other panelists, should people be asking themselves about, you know, about their ability to take on debt before they do that?
Yeah, I mean, with debt in general, I think it's just good. Like, that can be leverage. So not all debt is bad. You know, I think the idea of debt is you just, obviously, you're going to have to pay it back. And that's what you want to have the game plan for. If you're taking a business loan or a personal loan, or maybe leveraging credit cards, which I've seen a lot of people do to start their business, just understand there's usually an interest rate. You got to be aware of that interest rate. What is that minimum monthly payment every month? Work that into your budget, work it into your cash flow where you're making those payments on time every month, because that is with debt and credit, you know, that's a big thing here. And with your credit score, just paying your bills on time and keeping your credit utilization under that 30% ratio, is those two factors are the biggest part, 65% of the score. So even just making sure if you take a loan, set, you know, now we could do those automatic payments. You don't even have to think about it. It's just pulling and making sure that payment's going. That is the most important part. Just work it into your cash flow to pay off that loan. And you know, make sure whatever you're using the money for, hopefully, I think Kathy said it, you know, it's going to be an ROI. A dollar turns into $100. I mean, the idea is don't take money, more money than you need, right? We always want to, you know, take the least amount of money that, you know, in debt so that we can pay it back. And then whatever you're using as debt, think about it as leverage, and you want to, you know, get an ROI on that somehow.
So then, Kathy, let me ask you, was part of the reason that you were taking that $1 and you yourself not relying on others and turning it into $100, did you have a fear of debt?
I did. I grew up in a household that was the paycheck to paycheck, and I realized I had carried that into my family. And when I left the newspaper and started doing Crafty Chica full time, I knew I had to change that mindset in order to grow and thrive. And one of the things that I did to help with my money mindset was a couple years ago, I said, I want to have this experience of buying a brand new car in cash for my business. So in 8 weeks, I came up with these different formulas to get to the, I looked at the car, saw the price, and I came up with different formulas that I could use my business in 8 weeks. And I did it. And it was the best feeling ever. I totally want to scrapbook the moment of like being able to go in and buy a brand new car in cash. And now when I face different challenges, whether if it's money or time or anything like that, I look back to that moment and I said, I figured that out. And it was difficult, but I figured it out and I did it. I can do anything from this point. So it's deeper than the money. It goes into your mind, into your, you know, healing wounds from the past, all of that, to just lead a more positive, healthy life with your business so that you can give more, you can give better, and also be financially stable.
Yeah, listen, money is very emotional, right? It's sometimes not about what it's about. I think especially if you grew up in a family that didn't have a lot, it has a lot of emotion attached to it. Let's talk about cash flow since you mentioned cash. Brittany, maybe you can walk us through, and businesses generally, cash flow is critical if you're going to run a small business. So give us a 101 tutorial on this, Brittany.
Yeah, I mean, cash flow, I'm sure everyone here can relate. It, to me, I was a financial planner, and then I started my own my financial firm about 8 years ago, and then I sold it. But in the beginning, I had a very hard time with cash flow. You know, you're paying your people, and you get the tax bill, and then the money coming in never matches when it has to go out, and there's always this management involved, because there's no like set paycheck every month on the 15th of the month, you know. So it takes a lot in the beginning to understand your unique business and how you're getting paid. Every business is different, you know. Some businesses get paid immediately for the products or services. Others, there's a delay in payment, 30 days, 60 days, you know, if there's contract work. Maybe there's overhead you have to worry about, taxes you have to save for. So with cash flow, I think if you're a business owner, really spend time, take classes. I mean, Intuit QuickBooks actually has a lot of great tutorials on their website about cash flow. You know, go take classes on it, because even me, I was a certified financial planner in personal finance for so many years, and I still had so many challenges, and I still do. It's just I'm a lot better at managing them now with cash flow. So it's just one of those things that everybody has to kind of figure out their business cycle. Some, you know, seasons of your business are going to be more lucrative. Maybe, you know, the first 6 months of the year, there's a lot that you're doing, or the products, you know, based on what they are, that's the season for them. And then the remainder 6 months of the year, it's more dry. And so you have to prepare for that. So I think if you can take classes, hire help, a certified financial planner or a good CPA to help you manage all of that, the better off you'll be, because you'll just start to learn strategies and different things you can do in your own business, because your business is going to be different than everybody else's business, to set yourself up for success with cash flow management. And then I would just say, hang in there, because like you said, it's emotional. And I had so many breakdowns in the beginning when I started my company, at like, oh no, now this tax bill came, like how, like what I've, you know, like everything I thought I prepared for, you know, there's always the things that you don't prepare for, and you just got to keep, you know, building your resilience and knowledge so that the next time it happens, you're that much wiser of how you deal with it.
So then, Andres, I guess I'd go to you for any specific advice you would give anybody around a lesson maybe you've learned, either in a great way or maybe the hard way, about cash flow.
Listen, just be ready. Like she was saying, perhaps in my line of work, sometimes you don't get paid right away. You know, you don't get paid, you know, at the end of the week. You have to wait sometimes 30 or 60 days. So planning has been key. And that's one of the things I can tell to everyone watching is, you know, whatever you do, make sure, you know, you have enough cash flow to at least hold you until your first, you know, your first payment, because otherwise you're going to put yourself in a situation where, you know, like in my case, you can't be creative because you're thinking about all these other things. You know, you're thinking about money when you should be thinking about, you know, your business and how to make it grow and be creative.
How about from you, George? Was there a lesson that you learned about cash flow? I have to imagine as a stand-up, like, I don't even know how stand-ups deal with cash flow. I mean, the way I've heard it, people just kind of get paid at the end of the night, depending on how it goes. That can't be super reliable.
Yeah, you know, we didn't have a lot of cash in our family. My grandmother used to do a Christmas club, you know, like at the where you could save money for Christmas, and you would have money for Christmas. So there were those things to do that. I saw that movie Pay It Forward, and I started to help other people solo that. And I think in helping other people, it helped myself. You know, there has been a couple of people now because of social media that have come to me that had garment places, the t-shirt places, and they were starting out. And I let them use my name and I let them do some business. And now they're up and running as business people. But cash flow, in not having it, I was a bit possessed by it when it did start to show up in my bank account in 2002. And the more the show went on, which was great, the more money you made, the less I saved. And it wasn't until the show was over. And I remember this guy who did some television show said, you know, the thing that the mistake most people make is to think it's going to last forever. And it doesn't, and be prepared for when it ends, because it's going to seem like it's going to last forever. And I was not prepared for that. But also the sartén, the frying pan that was always on simmer for me was the fact that I was able to go on the road and to do stand-up. So that was always the machine that was allowing me to work in the other avenues. And Andres, as a chef, to think that Latinos now can eat the things that we love, and you can make it healthy, and you can still enjoy the food you love and live 20 years more is one of the major accomplishments, I think, culturally that we've made in making the food with our beautiful hands and our beautiful food, but also making it healthier and to convince people who have been used to a food one way that it's still going to be what you like, but it's going to be better for you and better for your family and better for everybody if you're still around as to see the kids grow up.
Yeah, absolutely. And also you could do it on social media. So those of us who don't really know how to cook, just watch and pretend that we could do it. And then we order in because I'm not that good at cooking. I'm really curious about this interesting next question. Has there been a moment, and I'm going to let everybody answer this, in your career where your culture or your community maybe hindered your growth? Maybe it was a lack of expectations. Maybe you didn't feel supported or didn't understand the direction that you were taking. We have a note here from Juliana, who's been listening into this, all this, Juliana Gonzalez Cruci, and she says, traditional organizations sometimes don't have the cultural competency to support the Latinx Hispanic community. Sometimes there's racism, sometimes there's discrimination. So I'm curious if within your own culture, did you ever feel like, wow, people aren't getting what my dream is, what my goals are? And anybody who wants to answer that, I'd love for them to jump in.
I'm going to start. I'm going to say for me, it was quite the opposite. They really lift me up. You know, when I got out of MasterChef and I lost the show on the final, people were just there to support me. My community were just there, like, you know, don't worry. They actually, you know, related to me and to what was happening. You know, they felt it was unfair. So, you know, I can't say my own community has ever hindered my growth or my business. Quite the opposite. They really lift me up, you know, in every chance they can. And it really made me, you know, it reminds you, you know, to be proud of who you are and where you come from when you see that kind of support and how you make other people feel, you know, that they see one of their own succeed.
My parents were both immigrants to this country, and my mom was worried. You know, her dream was like, go be a doctor, because it just felt so solid, right? Like nothing can go wrong if you're a lawyer or you're a doctor. No one in my family had ever been in TV. What does that even mean? What are the jobs there? George, I see you nodding your head. So I'm curious. I mean, when you go tell your family, you know, I'm going to use my head, not my hands. I'm going to go be a stand-up comedian. Like, that had to scare some people.
My grandmother said, I'm funnier than you. Take me with you. I used to watch I Love Lucy, of course. I mean, I went to Mexico and I saw it in Spanish and thought, just, man, wow. I saw Desi Arnaz and I saw Freddie Prinze in 1973. I was inspired by seeing somebody that looked like me that could do something. And I would go to the Walk of Fame and I would see George Burns or George Reeves. And I would imagine that it said George Lopez instead of Burns or Reeves. And in 2006, I got my star on the Walk of Fame, but also I got Freddie Prinze a star on the Walk of Fame too, because I wasn't gonna go in unless he was in and he wasn't in. And in a way for me to pay my respect to somebody who came before me was to have him get his star with his family there. And I talked to his mother in Puerto Rico and she was just so sweet. And it was very emotional for me. And in a humility that I thought I would never have, you know, Desi Arnaz was part of I Love Lucy and Freddie Prinze was part of Chico and the Man and George Lopez was George Lopez, the show. So, yeah. I mean, everything and the more impossible it seems, the better it is when it happens and everything seems impossible. So
then, Kathy, I'm curious because, of course, I mean, he's talking about paying respect and homage to you know, the culture and the people who sometimes their work is not valued, right? Their work isn't really seen. And it takes somebody who gets an opportunity to say, oh, no, I'm going to bring some people with me. Hold on. You know, all these other people, you might not know them, but I'm going to bring them with me and I'm going to elevate them too. And I feel, I mean, just looking behind you in your shot, that you do that all the time. Was that ever an issue for you to not feel like you were getting support? Did people ever say, hey, you know, this idea is not going to work. There's not going to be a market for what you're trying to do.
Well, for the most part, within community, it's been 100% support. there's a lot of women, viva la Grupos, you know, like, we want a craft, give us the craft projects. However, my challenge came with wanting to have a Latina brand in the general market that was for everybody. Because yes, number one, it's for our community, but I wanted, I would go into the craft store and see that I had, when my items are in Michaels, I could see I have a higher sell rate than this product line. Can I be in all year round and not just during Hispanic Heritage Month? And I was able to navigate to work with different manufacturers and retail brands like, you know, Barnes and Noble. They put my stuff in all year round, or other ones that, to elevate it, to see it all year round so that our community is reflected in on store shelves. And there's other brands too out there, Latina owned brands, in these past few years that I have seen in the general market on the store shelves right next to the other brands. To me, that is goals for all. And I love seeing products on store shelves this month. Everyone's celebrating. Our community is so supportive of each other because we see through social media our pain, our struggles, through stories, the tears of what we're going to make this work. And then when we see a big win to be in a national retail chain, we want to go and buy it. We want to show it off. We want to wear it because we want to show how excited we are and that it's deserving of all year round. So that has always been my thing. And I've looked at like Oprah, J-Lo, Tyra. I look at their websites and their brands when I was first starting out. And I said, I want to be the Crafty Chica version of J-Lo. Like, she has perfume, she has movies. I'm like, I'll have workshops, I'll have books, I'll have products. So you can take those bigger visions and tailor it to your own brand to have those successes. And I guarantee in our community, it's been nothing but support.
I love it. I love it. And finding your inspiration where you can find it is important. Brittany, I'm curious, is it crazy to think that you can scale a small business if you've got limited capital or you've got limited funding?
Definitely not crazy. I mean, I think George Lopez said it, like, anything is possible. I think it just comes down to having that vision and a strategy. I think scaling nowadays, just because of social media and the internet, is like, the opportunity is so great to be able to do things that we never were able to do just by posting a video on our Instagram or Facebook and getting a following. And then all of a sudden you have all these people looking at you for advice, or they want to buy your product or want to come to you for a service. So scaling can be very cost efficient. I mean, I actually built my entire financial firm and like all the, you know, brand recognition in the financial industry by posting videos on social media. So I actually teach other financial advisors now how to do that because it was free. I mean, you could, I mean, obviously you had to, you know, pay for a phone or a camera, but other than that, like, just to be able to create content, now I think just opens the door for so many people to scale. However, I would still say that there is strategy behind scaling because, you know, you can go from 0 to 100, but then you got to be able to maintain or deliver upon whatever it is that you said and have that successful business, you know, the business systems behind it to keep it running, right? You know, I've seen a lot of too, like, startups go from nothing to all of a sudden, and then they can't sustain it, which is obviously not the goal. We want to be able to have a business that we could either have for our lifetimes or eventually sell for, you know, profit. So scaling it is totally doable, but also have the strategy so that when it happens, you can handle it too.
You know, I want to say something. You know, a lot of people will say that a seminal moment in their lives was when we went to the moon or when a rocket took off. But I think for me, I saw a guy selling corn in the park with mayonnaise and cheese and dressed up when everyone else was just maybe using salt and some butter. But the Latino had put cheese and mayonnaise and he dressed it up and it was simple. And once you took a bite, you were hooked. So seminally, like, this guy went to and just steamed some corn and started a business. And then it's just all over the world now. I mean, I saw a lady trying to eat an elote with a knife and a fork. So it's not a perfect world. But It's amazing. You can steam one ear of corn and change the world.
You all have clearly had a lot of community support, but I'd love for each of you to talk about the person who had your back. Was there a moment where maybe you just weren't sure and there was somebody who stuck it out with you and gave you some great guidance about your support? Who wants to kick me off with that?
I'll go. That's easy for me, my wife. You know, I was not a social media user. In fact, I didn't like using social media because I thought it was just a big waste of time. And my wife, she said, you know, we were stuck at home during the pandemic. And she's like, hey, you know, you have, you know, this following of people, you know, that follow you after the show, you got to do something for them. You got to do it. And I'm like, you know, the one thing I don't want to do is just create meaningless content. So I said, let's do, if we're going to do social media, you know, we got to buy all this equipment and we got to start filming. She's like, go, let's do it. You know, we can do it. But, you know, as long as you have, you know, a strategy, you know, like Brittany was saying, you know, we can do it. And she was just there 100% of the time. And the goal was to create, you know, valuable content, useful content, you know, a way for people to actually, you know, cook for themselves, to, you know, feed themselves better, healthier. And that's what we did. And it was just all thanks to, you know, her pushing me in the beginning.
How about for you, Brittany?
I had a few. So one was my spiritual advisor, who I think just always believed in me. Like, she would always just make things seem so simple. Like, you know, a lot of things that were said today, like, anything's possible. Of course you can do it. And, you know, those moments when you're on the floor crying at the bottom thinking, I can't do it anymore. Those little words of encouragement really mean so much. And then my parents, I think they've always been, even in the beginning, even though, like you, Soledad, they wanted probably more traditional path for me. Once they started to see my vision and see the success, they are always my number one fans. And it's really sweet. My dad is Mexican American. I mean, my great grandma came from León, Mexico and had 12 children here. So I come from a long line of strong women. And I think, you know, just that kind of encouragement from my parents, like, of course you can support me, even though they would be also giving me the feedback all the time of things I could do better and better and better, was always, and they still are, it's the best. So I'm very, very blessed and grateful.
Kathy?
Oh, definitely my husband and kids. They have been through this from day one. The kids have been there while they were growing up, seeing everything that I'm doing. And real quick, I wanted to piggyback on the earlier question, like about cash flow and everything. These are a couple things that if people can do for their business to help think bigger, is my husband and the kids and I, this is what we do. If someone were to gift you $10,000 for your business, what would you do with it? How would you turn it into more money? Number two, if someone were to offer you a product line or a book, what would it be? Plan for those things. And that's what the importance of having that support of my husband and my kids, because we sit down and we talk about this, of what are our own personal goals for our businesses so that we can support each other.
How about you, George? Who was the person who, when maybe you thought like, huh, this might not work out, actually was actually there to push you forward?
You know, there's been a few people so that, but I want to say that I think we have an intuition, being Latino. I think we have a sense of ourself, and the moment you start to believe in your intuition and believe in yourself, then you become your own inspiration and you become the best advocate for you, because maybe somebody's not with you, maybe you're alone in the toughest time, and at some point, when you want to be successful, you're going to be afraid, and you're going to have to be able to handle that fear, and you're going to have to be able to tell yourself that you're good enough and that it's possible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. While relying on yourself. Excellent. So I'm curious, from each of you, there's a lot of people who are listening. I'm getting lots of notes from folks who are weighing in. And I'm curious the advice that you would give to somebody who's either at the beginning stages of starting their small business, or maybe even in a working for somebody else, but thinking about starting their small business. What advice would you give them? And I'm going to take, Brittany, you've said a couple of times and others have picked up on it, like have a strategy. So I'm going to take that one off the table because I think that's great advice, but we've covered it. Who wants to start? Maybe Kathy, you can start for us and we'll just walk through. What advice would you give someone who says, I really want to do this, but I'm just a little worried?
Well, I would say to know what the end goal is that you want. Have intention for everything, from writing an Instagram post to your money to what you want out of your business. Because if you don't have that end goal, you're just going to get lost and be all over the place. It could be as easy as starting with a to-do list every day. Do something every day that will move you closer to working on your business or reaching a certain goal for your business. Definitely having that intention.
Brittany?
I would say a few things. Find business owners that can be your mentors, because just like if you're a new mom and a new parent, I think you want to kind of talk to other new parents. Same with the business. You got to be able to bring some people into your life if they're not already that can be with you with those challenges, speak the same language. That's very important. And then another thing I would say is, as you're starting and as you grow and as you continue to grow, always keep your eye on the money. You're going to have different people come in and help you, but at the end of the day, it's your money, it's your responsibility. And the soon, like, you know, I think there's been multiple times even in my career, I'm like, I just want to delegate it all. I want to hand it all off. But that's not always wise, because even if they're trusted professionals or it's a husband-wife duo, you still need to be involved. You still need to know what's going on, because it does matter. And it is your hard work. You know, we're working hard to have something and to build wealth. And you got to keep your eye on that along the way.
Andres.
Don't overthink it. Just do it. You know, I think sometimes we waste a lot of time thinking about all the negative things that could happen. Oh, you know, I got to do this, but this could happen and that could happen. I'm like, think about those things. Just do it. And just things, you know, will work itself. They will work themselves out as you go along. Sometimes you have to improvise as you go, but don't just overthink it. Just go for it. That's my one, you know, piece of advice.
And George, how about from you?
Let's not assume that everything is going to be no. You know, sometimes we'll look at somebody's face and we'll be like, oh, they're going to say no. Look at her face. But we just can't assume that everything's going to be no. And if it is no, then go find somebody that says yes. But don't be afraid of no. When you hear one no and they're like, oh, they're going to say no. Last time I went, they said no. They're going to say no. Let's not be afraid of no.
I love that. When they say no, just bring an elote with cheese and mayo. And
yes.
Yes.
And not a
throw glitter, edible glitter.
I took the cauliflower tortilla and I'm like, all right, this is another world now. It's going to be a better world.
I love it. A big thank you to our small business panelists, guys. This is really, really great advice, and I think really good strategies as well. Kathy Cano Murillo, of course, and Andres de Oliveira, and Brittany Castro, really great advice. And George Lopez, always nice to talk to you. Always great to have an opportunity to hear about your backstory and your life and to have you inspire other folks. Really appreciate it. Nice to talk to all of you.
Thank you so much.
And everybody else, for more information, be sure to check out the resources section. It's happening below the chat. You're going to be able to access it even after the event ends. And keep your eyes on the QuickBooks blog for a recap of this event to share with your community. And a big thanks to all of you. George, what are you going to play us off with? I mean, come on, what do you got?
I love it. This was awesome. This was awesome.
Well, thank you. We really appreciate you, of course. A big thanks to everybody for joining us. And let's keep this conversation going. Of course, we're still on Twitter. Use the hashtag #UnidosWeGrow. Have a great day. George, give us a final song to take us out.
Latinos. It's a one-word song.
We love it.